Thank you for auditing Professor Pretty Feet's Half Step Review, the always positive new music review show hosted by a French professor who's going to be reviewing R.A.P. Ferreira's new album, The Light Emitting Diamond Cutter Scriptures. This is funny because this is my second review this year of a R.A.P. Ferreira album, and it's my second review in a row in which it's following a week after a review of a Playboy Cardi event. So first it was his album, now most recently it was his concert. And I like pairing these two together because they show the sort of opposite ends of what hip-hop can be and what hip-hop can do. I often talk about hip-hop being the most important artistic development in school in the history of humanity, and people think I'm joking or I'm using hyperbole, but I'm not. And I think part of the reason why is you can see how far apart these two artists are while still very much participating in the same conversation in the same genre. Now this is the second album of the year. The first one I reviewed was Bob's Son, and it was very specifically about the relationship with the poet Bob Kaufman. And that is a giant of an album. I mean, my year-end reviews are coming up, and that will probably make it on there in the top 10 of hip-hop. He produced it all himself. It's this sort of monolithic masterpiece, all a dedication to this poet who I didn't know very much. Please watch my video that I made about it up there. It's very good, I think. I have a lot of comments about poetry and hip-hop, which I have a somewhat questionable relationship with. And this seems to be its less ambitious, less accomplished, although not less enjoyable follow-up, where Bob's Son was really about Bob Kaufman and his experience and the way that R.A.P. Ferreira identified with him and tried to glorify him. This is a more general work about the status of the poet. To make poetry is the goal. This album is about making poetry and continuing to make poetry. Now, in this case, poetry uses hip-hop, and that's very intentional. I think here what we have is a poet who figured out a way to make a living, and very few poets are able to do that. He has a good enough flow, he has a good enough sense of production, both himself and choosing other people to produce, as he did on this album, that he found a way to be a full-time poet. There's very few people who are able to do that without being in academia, and I think he deserves credit for that. One of the things that makes him so interesting for me is his just never-ending reliance and emphasis on intertextuality, the term which I use quite often, created by a French philosopher, Kristeva, that talks about the relationship between different works of art. Okay, so a piece of art that references another piece of art. And in that relationship, we find out more about both pieces. He is a master of intertextuality, but he's a master of doing it in the best possible way. Listening to a R.A.P. Ferreira album carefully is very similar. He's like a very cool professor. A cool professor who doesn't really have a syllabus, who doesn't really worry about student learning outcomes, but just sort of talks. And then every once in a while, he'll make reference to something, and you find yourself scrambling on the internet or scrambling in a book to try to find out what he's talking about. There are references on here that I caught. There's references on here that I completely missed. But he's very much interested in memorializing, like, the 1950s, the 1960s in art. The very avant-garde, very East Coast-centered, beat poets, abstract expressionist artists, that whole kind of school of thought, which has kind of passed out of fashion, but is being taken by him, and he has this great series of conversations happening. And it's all constantly on the status of the poet. And people often ask me, you know, Sky, what books should I have? What should be in my library? And I don't always have a good answer, because, you know, there's certain novels I think everyone should know very well, you know, Flaubert, Proust, Rabelais, in the French canon. But when it comes to how do you have a good bookshelf, my main piece of advice is this: a dictionary of etymology, the history of words. A good rap artist, a good musician, a good lyricist will give you cause to constantly go back to an etymological dictionary. Because it's not just about what words mean. It's where they come from, what linguistic family they come from, what other words are they associated with, what is the deeper meaning behind that which we say. I think all art can be taken at the root, at the very like at the word level, and we can learn a lot. To defend poetry is to defend, I'm here on page 810. The word poet comes originally from poet, from Old French, poet, a learned borrowing from Latin, directly from Latin poeta, from Greek poetes, an early variant of poetis, author or maker. Fundamentally, that is what a poet is. A poet is a maker. It comes from the Greek word, which means to make. So this whole project is so insistent and dedicated on the value of making poetry, which is in and of itself redundant. You're making when you say you make poetry. But it's a great defense, and it's a great defense in the name of the humanities. You know, I am a professor, and as a professor in the humanities, you're constantly under siege having to defend yourself. We need the humanities, and an album like this helps to show why. But let's get into the album a little bit deeper. Let's actually go, I want to take a single track, which I think exemplifies his style. It's probably my second favorite track on the album, but I think it's the most exemplary. I'm going to include a link to it up there. Cemalet Hasadim. Already, the intertextuality begins. What the hell is a Cemalet Hasadim? Now, maybe some of my viewers are Jewish and are laughing at the screen saying, Sky, how do you not know? I've only been to one bar mitzvah, so I don't know. Maybe I missed it. I should probably learn more. I should do more Jewish studies. It's this concept of doing good for good's sake, like without any hope of being recompensed, without any hope of being rewarded. That's this concept of Cemalet Hasadim. I might be mispronouncing it. I don't speak Hebrew or Yiddish. So this idea of doing something good for its own sake, in the context of this album, this mysterious album, I mean, the title of the album, The Light-Emitting Diamond Cutter Scriptures, I mean, LED is light-emitting diode, so he's replacing diode with diamond and scriptures, very unclear. The point of this album is that it is art for art's sake. It is a gift of art, not to be paid, not to make money, not to be rich. One of the most consistent themes on the album is how obscene it is that rappers are paid, that poets are expected to be on the Forbes list. And so we have this whole idea of a Cemalet Hasadim. It is a gift that he is giving us for its own sake. I believe that's the idea. It's the second best beat on the album, just this great drum line. Just a great, like seriously, you have to listen to this. Like, it must be a live drummer with some great drum fills and just very smoky, simple keyboards behind. It's his very calm drawl. And it starts right off the bat with a meditation about the importance of art. You know, you might not die if you don't have art, but art is required to live. Like right off the bat, he has these two art critics speaking and being quoted all throughout the album, talking about the importance of art. And mind you, when he's talking about the importance of art, it doesn't matter if he's talking about a film director or a painter or a sculptor, they are all poets. They are creators. If I may be so bold as to suggest that I am a poet, this review is my creation, right? When you are a creator, you are a poet. Wouldn't it be funnier if on YouTube we called ourselves poets? Instead of content creators, it's a little bit less insulting. Anyways, so the album begins with this often repeated line. There's two lines that are repeated over and over again. I'll get to the second one soon. The first one is "Rap Ferreira will rap forever." It turns out his name is actually R.A.P. Like that, like his initials are R.A.P. Ferreira. So that's funny. That's his actual name. And then the first verse just has a great example of some of this intertextuality, things I don't quite understand. The road to hell is piloted with compliance. Morongo Indian, Mafongo Cimarron, my uncle ain't no Simeon. So, you know, Mafongo is an African dish. Morongo Indian, I don't even know what that really means. I think that might be a tribe. My uncle ain't no Simeon, talking about the African roots and often attacked or racist accusations of Simeon-like traits. Which, of course, we're all from Africa. And we're all from Simeons. So why has anyone ever started pointing fingers? It's not very clear. Just to remind you, in case you don't know, we are closer to chimps and porpoises are to dolphins. That's how, anyways, that's not to diminish the human creation. Because neither porpoises nor dolphins made Space Mountain or this rap album, but still. So he goes to this great first verse, and then an interlude, talking about how art doesn't care about rules, and then this amazing second verse. Style like steam bent bamboo. He has this experience of life. You get the sense he's a very, very well-read guy. I assume multiple different, like, degrees, like, higher level degrees. Because his intertextuality is never just about art or just about music or just about poetry. It's also about history. And it's also like this. I mean, how do you even think about comparing your style to bamboo bent with steam? It's, the whole album is just littered with these lines, which, you know, he has so many of them, you could just watch them go by and not really pay attention to them. But what a line. With that patch of turbulence when the flight attendants sit down too. It's kind of spooky, huh? I'm afraid of flying. When the flight attendant sits down, I just figure it's over. It was a good run. I enjoyed every sandwich. Time to go. that's what happens to me. So to like bring this in here and to compare his style to that moment on an airplane, which is a very specific moment that's very scary that most of us can relate to, and then steam bent bamboo, and then he goes further with this weird metaphor, active shooter at the Chateau Marmont, you know, the hotel in Los Angeles where I stayed one night, and I saw Tobey Maguire. That was my brush with fame. Active shooter at the Chateau Marmont, riots, looters, various sidearms, pythons on leashes. I remember the smell of sky burning. This apocalyptic political message about rioting, about the death of fame culture, very unclear. And then it ends with the nicest bit of intertextuality on the entire album. I think if the last album was Bob's son, this album could be Jackson's son. Although just like you can confuse Bob's son with like Bob Dylan or Bob Marley, you could confuse Jackson Pollock with Michael Jackson. But it's of course a reference to Jackson Pollock. When people ask me what should I have on my bookshelf, I'm giving you expensive books, but these are good books. You need a book like the Dictionary of Etymology, and you need some gigantic art history book like this. And you need to read most of it. Take your time. Take years. You need a book like this to give you the overview of art, Western, Eastern, all art, because then you'll see a good explanation, in case you ever need a good explanation, even better than you get on Wikipedia, of Jackson Pollock's art there, his drip art there. So that's what's referenced. They're talking about how Jackson Pollock only did his famous drip style for 4 years, and then he abandoned it. Compare it to making fire, and then he died. And this idea of like having all this creativity, but art for art's sake, he abandons it, he has to keep moving. If you're going to be a poet, if you're going to be a maker, a creator, you actually have to go beyond just what you're comfortable doing. You have to keep making other things. All of that is just in one song, you know? Just the image of the style being like bent bamboo, and you're there and thinking about that in the airplane, and then this whole conversation between these two art critics about the importance and the value of Jackson Pollock. Let's go through the rest of the album a little bit quicker. It starts off with contrapuntal, counterpoint. That's what contrapuntal means, like when things go against each other in music. It's counterpoint is when you'll have two different melodies playing at the same time. Here we have kind of a slow jazzy sound with some chimes, very kind of sleepy rhyming, almost slam poetry. Nice kind of singing point. There's a couple points in this album where he sings, just kind of fly away. The bridge includes a poem by Ismail Reed, a reference to a poem, Cowboy in the Boat of Ra. Thank you to Lyric Genius. I'll get back to them later, but someone there commented that that's where this comes from. I will say, I wanted to tell you to add this, the Oxford Book of American Poetry. My father gave this to my family for Christmas this year. He didn't label it, so we didn't know it was going to be a Christmas gift. But neither Bob Kaufman nor Ismail Reed are in this book. So I can't recommend it. You know, if you don't have Bob Kaufman, who's become one of my favorite poets ever since he was introduced to me by R.A.P. Ferreira, maybe we need to wait for the next edition. At the end of this song, he says over and over again, the flower's duty is to bloom. going back with the central theme of this album, which is, as a poet, he has a duty, he has an obligation, he has to save society, he has to save himself, he has to save civilization. His duty is to bloom. An artist's duty is to make art, not to be a business person. Brother Muzone's library card. If you don't remember, Brother Muzone was that menacing character in The Wire, the member of the Nation of Islam, like one of the scariest guys in the show, filled with scary guys. Grab the mic like I ain't gotta be hard. Flow courtesy, Brother Muzone, library card. So I love this idea. He talks about how he doesn't have to be hard. He rarely flexes on this album or brags about himself, except to say that he doesn't have to really brag or flex or very much. Nice kind of jaggy beat. I'm not gonna give the names of all the producers. I didn't recognize the names of any of them, but there are some very good, all the way throughout the production here is good, with spectacular production. Yeah, I will tell you that the spectacular production on Gemalot Hasadim, I didn't write down the producer. So, sorry about that. Put it in the comments who produced that, in case I forgot, which I did. And then in the chorus here, Brother Muzone's library card, the figure of Black Orpheus comes back. You hear my throat's going? I don't edit these things. I don't have a script. So what I do is I drink hot honey water to calm my throat while filming. So allow me to have some hot honey water before I get to Black Orpheus. The ingredients of hot honey water are honey and hot water. Black Orpheus, the 1959 movie, is an amazing piece of art. Thanks to R.A.P. Ferreira, I rewatched it last night. The wife, Dr. and Mrs. and I said I want to watch Black Orpheus. She's like, I thought you didn't like Brazilian music. Nope, let's watch it. It's an amazing movie. I could do an entire video about Black Orpheus. It's so good. It's such an amazingly vibrant movie. It's made by white French people. Marcel Camus is the director, but it stars entirely Brazilians of African descent, and it takes place in Rio de Janeiro during a carnival, and it takes the entire story of Orpheus and Eurydice and transposes it to mid-century Brazil. It's heartbreaking, it's tender, it's sweet, it's funny, it's exciting, it's energetic. The music is all the way through, and at the center of it is the character of Black Orpheus. So Orpheus, if you don't know, he was the guy in Greek mythology who fell in love with Eurydice, and then she died mysteriously, and he went down to Hades, not hell, to Hades, the land of the dead, and he played his lyre so well. He played his instrument so well. He was such a beautiful poet. Because in those days, poets also sang, right? They didn't write at all. They sang and they played. He was able to charm Cerberus, the three-headed dog. He was able to charm Hades and Persephone, and he was able to take Eurydice back with him. Of course, the law was he couldn't turn around and see her. If he turned around to check that he was there, she would disappear. He had to go on faith. Just before leaving Hades, he turns around, she's gone forever, and he spends the rest of his life playing music and writing songs. And so in Black Orpheus, it's a great transposition. The magic element of it gets a little bit sort of into cultural appropriation of West African religions, which I'm not a big fan of, but It's done well enough that I don't think it's as cringeworthy as it sounds. But it's this great, he's this amazing character, Black Orpheus. He's a trolley conductor, and he's engaged to someone else, but he's like courting Eurydice, and he's like charismatic, and he's a great singer, and he's a great poet, and he's sort of just this footloose, light, deep character. And for a movie from, you know, not the last 5 years, its representation of non-white people, considering how it was made, is amazingly even-handed, astoundingly unracist, and it's just a great piece of art. What am I talking about? Why am I here? Oh, I'm talking about R.A.P. Ferreira. I'm telling you about this intertextuality. It's a whole... You could just, if you do the damn work and you take this guy's music and you really give it the respect it deserves, you're going to find yourself with a full reading list and a full watching list, and your whole life is going to be better. My life is better because of Bob Kaufman. My life is better because revisiting Black Orpheus caused me to love Black Orpheus in a way I didn't know. And in this song, he calls himself the metamorphosis of Black Orpheus. So implying that he is like Black Orpheus, that he's a great poet who's so good he can make the sun rise, who's a great performer, charismatic guy, but he's a metamorphosis, a changed form of it. And in the movie itself, Orpheus is sort of hinted to be the actual Orpheus, not just the Orpheus in Brazil, but there's a kind of intergenerational concept, almost like rebirth. So potentially, R.A.P. Ferreira is Orpheus and is Black Orpheus. It's just great. This song's also kind of funny. He has a kind of fun sense of humor. I was born a weirdo. Never fear, though. Our legions seem decent. What it is, what it isn't, what it soon will be. Till I part the seas and fart in the key of E sharp. E sharp is just an F, so he's farting an F. It's like he's farting art. I don't have the time to go into the Bactinian concept of the carnival and the high becoming low. God damn, I sort of want to. Mikhail Bakhtin was another 20th century philosopher who talked about the importance of carnival in literature. And the reason that carnival is so important, and carnival is the setting for Black Orpheus, is that, you know, the king gets to be a street person, and a street person gets named the king. There's an inversion of societal values. And it's the mixing of the sacred and the profane. So I think R.A.P. Ferreira right here, till I part the seas and fart in the key of E sharp, he's being funny. He's using crude humor, but he's doing it while referring to himself to be like Moses, all in this much higher, lofty goal of being a poet in a world of commerce. Wait a minute. This is not on purpose. I'm not trying to do the thing that R.A.P. Ferreira does, where I give you all these references and then you have to go out and find them. But have some fun reading Bakhtin. That's some of my favorite stuff. And read my article, where I tie it together with Rabelais. Okay. Hyperion, very kind of woozy, strange beat, makes you slightly nauseous. It feels like the chorus came out of an ad lib. A TV for a head, so let's F with the antennas. Basically slam poetry all the way through. In my hands, loosely feel loosey, date myself by Stepan Watusi, handsome rambler, skate goofy. I was in the second grade when I shot my first Uzi. Now that's Lil, 6'3", the vert ill. See how quickly cats get deconstructed. This kind of playfulness is all the way throughout the album because he's saying he shot an Uzi, so he makes you think of the rapper Lil Uzi Vert. So he says, my first Uzi, now that's Lil, 6'3". Saying his presumed height now, the Vert ill, so he gets the whole name Lil Uzi Vert, except he takes it where, and then he says, you see how quickly cats get deconstructed, because he has just deconstructed the name Lil Uzi Vert and applied it to himself. Flummoxed boxer, hands in the toaster, you are the lobster. Lobster. Rappers win Oscars, dress up like a FedEx, to spit a rhyme, chief executive officer. Rappers win Oscars. It's a whole other theme throughout this album. Why are rappers trying to be rich? Why are they trying to be accepted? What they should be instead are poets. Wedding Cake Eighths is the next song, another choppy drum beat. Basically drums with no melody, a little bit like the Hasadim song that I like so much. And here's a little bit of my problem with, okay, I'm gonna say something and you can just say okay boomer in the comments, that's fine. I'm gonna say something here, I'm gonna complain about the world briefly. And say what's wrong with it as a humanist. Okay. So this song is very complicated, filled with references, okay? Like the Panopticon and Erewhon and all these weird things it's making references to, okay? And you go to the Lyric Genius page as of this morning, and only one thing is annotated in the entire song. Not these other very complex things, but the title itself, Wedding Cake Eighths, which is apparently some strain of weed. And there's like four paragraphs describing its effects, describing how it looks, describing its, you know, like the most subscription to High Times description you could possibly have of a weed strain. So this is me okay boomering you a little bit, saying like, well, maybe if you spent this much time looking into Black Orpheus, as opposed to which kind of weed can I consume in order to be like this, you know what I mean? Like, it's just so superficial. Like, I understand, that's fine. People do weed, and I don't like weed, that's my own thing. You know, but it's like he's giving us so much to think about and so much to reference. But if what you pick up from the album is just, a bunch of weird words and smoking weed is fun, then it's a real shame. It's a real, like, you're just scratching the surface and you're doing the easy part, the consuming part, right? Because drugs are consumers, right? Pepsi, weed, it's the same thing. You know, like, you're just at that level. And he's trying to give you poetry. He's trying to get you to go deeper into these ideas, into this concept of the artist. But hey, if it weren't for the lyric genius comments, I wouldn't have known about the Ismail Reed poem. So it's not like there's only idiots on there. And the person who posted that isn't an idiot. It's useful. I didn't know that Wedding Cake was a kind of weed strain. How would I possibly know that? It was just the four paragraphs. And then you have the word panopticon. No one even took the time to just do a lazy Foucault reference or Jeremy Bentham. You know what I mean? Like, just the easiest possible reference you could possibly make. That wasn't highlighted on Rap Genius, but this Wedding Cake was. He has maybe he is from Maine, or at least he lived in Maine for a long time, and he has just the most Maine lyric ever. In brightness, smell the ocean, picture my flow as seagulls pooping on you. He uses the S word, but the idea of his flow being seagulls pooping on you, that's just part of living in Maine, is the seagulls. He talks a lot about coming back from exile. Exile from where? I wonder if this is exile going back to Maine, or if this is the exile of the artist, or if this is the exile of Black Orpheus. What is this exile, and what is he coming back to? What does it all mean? Humboldt Park, Jabaritos, it's a kind of sandwich. Muted trumpet, a very, very amazing opening line, and I would now like to thank Lyric Genius. Okay, lyricgenius.com. Thank you, because somebody was able to point out the genius of this line right here. Frank talk like Biko. Thanks to the little message, I was able to understand the intertextuality of this. I'm not a great historian. I'm an okay historian of, you know, French and Francophone history and American history, but certainly not South African history. Steve Biko was one of the founders of the sort of anti-apartheid movement. He was one of the major figures that was bringing sort of a pan-African consciousness and a fight against colonial oppression, especially in South Africa. He had a pen name. That pen name was Frank Talk. So through this one little line, I now spent 10 minutes reading about Steve Biko. I now understand, oh, he was the person that Cry Freedom was based on. He was assassinated a day before I was born, like the day before my actual birthday. You know, so like I was able to go on this whole thing. So not only did I learn about Bob Kaufman and Ismail Reed, but I'm also learning about history. And it's all in here, and it's not gratuitous. He's not just saying it because it's cute. It's actually saying it because it's important, because that's part of his style as well. There is a militance underneath all of this that's being emphasized by something like Frank Talk, like Biko. Then Gemalot Hasidim. Then the next song, Black Mission Figs. Cool kind of like rap forever loops in the beginning. Another great beat, back-to-back great beats here. More of a science fiction-y feel here. The guest rapper, Eldon Summers, sounds a lot like Rap Forever, but just with a British accent, which is nice. Next song is called East Nashville. My number one problem about Rap Forever is I have a friend who lives in Maine, and he's really into hip-hop, and his son, his young son, is getting into hip-hop and loves hip-hop producers, and I was so excited because I found Rap Ferreira, and I told him that he lived in Maine, and he lived like near this bowling alley we went once, and then my friend went down, and he'd moved to Nashville. So, like, I was all excited, this image of, like, my friend meeting Rap Ferreira and hanging out in some random record store in Maine. And so this song is about all over the place, though. It is partly about Maine. The beat is almost like a Steely Dan sounding song with him kind of humming along. This is him having fun. The whole song is basically like I've Been Everywhere Man by Johnny Cash, but just him doing his version of it. Starts off with the enigmatic line, my girl built like a Tyrannosaurus. I don't know what that means. He references the photographer Ansel Adams. Playing around with place names like Memento and Sacramento, and then saying sacraments. He takes a tour of the entire world that he has visited. All right, the entire, basically it's just a tour everywhere he's seen. while also emphasizing maybe a little bit of his loneliness and the loneliness of travel. There's a cute little melody at the end, I'll never stop, you know I'll never quit. And this is a very essential theme to the album, Rap Forever Will Rap Forever, you know I'll never quit. It seems like he's telling himself more than he's telling us, because it has to be lonely and difficult to be a full-time poet, and he is. Fortunately, he's smart enough and talented enough to also be a rapper, which means he can have credit, but he's not doing the rap game. He's not. He is a rapper. I'm not saying he's not a rapper, but this is not the rap game. It just isn't. This is the poetry game. And he's just able to like illuminate other people and get them in and to just sit with an album of poetry. Praise and Worship is the next song. Opens up with a quote from a Sam Fuller movie from like 1950. This guy is just too cool. I mean, I've seen a couple Sam Fuller movies, but like, what the hell? This guy's like the coolest, you know? And this whole quote is about this person who's imitating a cultured man, sort of implying maybe he has a sense of imposter syndrome. And it's just one verse. Includes the line, Atlas sneezed and I brought a tissue. I don't know what it means, but it's pretty funny. Uptown 37, this I have the producer's names, Tony Bevilacqua and Nalipa, is just, this may be like top three beats of the year. I'm serious. Top three hip hop beats of the year, Uptown 37. This thing is devastatingly cool. I've never heard anything like it. It's these like flowing guitars with these lush layers and these kind of blaring sounds. It sounds a little bit like the sea. A little bit like a sort of trancey rock and roll song. I don't know what it is, but it's such a gorgeous and interesting and challenging song. I absolutely love it. It's like a subpoena for Mr. Bob Dabalina. He references the old Del the Funky Homo Sapiens song. He even talks about things being Dymaxian, which is super weird that he's making a Buckminster Fuller reference. I'm trying to look here on my bookshelf. My dad used to give me a Buckminster Fuller book like every year because he's totally obsessed with Buckminster Fuller. Let's see. Oh, there it is. There you go. Pride of the Spaceship Earth by Buckminster Fuller. You know, that's the Dymaxian shape, means like the most effective way, and Buckminster Fuller developed a whole bunch of alternative architecture. I don't know, but hearing it in a rap song was a bit odd because it reminded me of growing up. And then he really talks about how terrible it is that rappers try to be on the Forbes list and how sort of ungodly, it's unworthy of art to just try to be rich. Another one of the themes of the album is not just that he'll continue forever, but that artists should not be so dependent on making money. Here's some of his lyrics. Worm in the rainwater cistern, pain in my system, clod of burned garlic and corn smut. My little harlot chortles for more nut. This flow my horcrux, daddy row warbucks, with my road dogs, no tour bus. No amount of money could afford us. What's morbid is there's poets who want to be on the Forbes list. I will be gorgeous and homeless, stealing from your fortress, bad habits, no abacus. But we asking why would the devil need an advocate? I don't do this very often, but oh! Why does the devil need an advocate? That's a great line. The whole thing, I'll be gorgeous and homeless. Like he's flexing on not wanting money, on not using money, on how not materialistic he is. It doesn't feel as preachy to me as it sounds. And I love the idea of what's morbid is there's poets who want to be on the Forbes list. And then it ends with Bill Moyer talking to David Foster Wallace, which got me to watch the interview with David Foster Wallace and Bill Moyer, which is a great interview. It's available on YouTube. And then a quote from Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas with Johnny Depp, you know, the Hunter S. Thompson adaptation. And there we have him talking about losing money and people still humping the American dream. And it becomes much larger where you understand the kind of anti-money, anti-materialist stance that Hunter S. Thompson sort of takes on a lot of Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas is being transformed to the song. That's the nature of intertextuality. It's a conversation, like he passed things back and forth. So he's taking a little bit of that message, and then after you hear him saying, after he loses a bet in the movie, I need to learn to enjoy losing. I think that could be an important lesson. I need to learn to enjoy losing. Last Jedi. Hot Breath is the final song, a very disjointed beat, hardly a beat at all. One of my favorite lines, it's the Shaka Zulus versus the Clarence Thomases. Okay, so then you have to look up the history of the Shaka Zulu, the tribes in southern Africa who fought against the colonials in the Zulu Wars, versus the Clarence Thomases. Clarence Thomas is the first African-American on the Supreme Court. I mean, the first Republican African-American on the Supreme Court. And he's very famous for being very conservative and not being very well loved by militant African-Americans. So it's the difference between like a real fighter versus a fake fighter. And if you're not paying attention, if you're not taking the intertextual challenge, if you're not clicking on every single non-weed related thing on Lyric Genius, you might miss this. But right here, like the fight for the soul of international black resistance, really, you know, are you going to be the people who are fighting the colonial powers and the racist powers with all the weapons that you have and revolting in the street? Or are you going to be co-opted by the system, participating in and perpetuating the persecution of your own people? Shaka Zulu. Versus Clarence Thomas's. This is good stuff. You know, when I said it's not as good as Bob Kaufman album, it's just because that album is so good. And then this whole last song is very political. It ends with him quoting the Ralph Bakshi movie, Coonskin, which is a very complicated and interesting movie about American racism, but it's made by a white guy. I've seen sections of Coonskin. It's a very hard watch now. But it's quoting Scatman Crothers, who you may remember from The Shining, as being the guy who asks Doc if he likes ice cream. And it's this like really interesting thing about, you know, representations of African Americans in culture, and just keeps on saying, I'm the N-word man, I'm the N-word man. Very political at the end here. And then the very sort of ending, you hear the sounds of trolleys. Ding, 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 ding. And that is your reward. Professor Sky, Professor Pretty Feet, that is your reward for having rewatched Black Orpheus. You remembered the movie, but you had forgotten that he was a trolley operator. All of a sudden, this trolley feels like I'm imagining R.A.P. Ferreira at the front, and it's that scene in the beginning, and he's telling me to get on the trolley and go to Carnival with him. Metamorphosis. It's a Playboi Carti song that he didn't play at the concert, and I was upset about that. The metamorphosis of Black Orpheus. It's all hip-hop, it's all great, and that's the end of my review. What did you think of the R.A.P. Ferreira album? I think I need to probably go back to his previous works, but he's releasing so much new stuff, maybe I don't need to. I appreciate you watching. Please smash the like bucket. Please subscribe. Buy my merch. I'm soon going to be getting the first shipment, a new vessel for my hot honey water. Check that out in the links. I have a Patreon if you want to help me buy money, buy art. There's the camera.